We're going to sing He Lives, if you would. Sing along with us. Here we go.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's all. Talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how, I know he lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His love.
The story of unseen things above. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because satisfies my longing. this Sunday as we celebrate Palm Sunday and the fact that Jesus Christ gave his life on the cross for us, and that he rose on that third day on Easter Sunday. What a blessed week, couple of weeks we're going to have as we celebrate that at the cross.
And in the famous words of Minnie Pearl, I'm through singing now. No, we're not through singing, are we? We've got a song in our hearts and joy in our souls. We have a lot to sing about. Good to see you this week. We are finishing up our journey with Jesus. We've been on this journey for well over a year and a half. We began over in Bethlehem. Well, actually, we started in, Nazareth and went to Bethlehem and back to Nazareth and Egypt. And we've been all over Israel, and we are finishing up in the area of Jerusalem. Next week will be our final session, 31 March. And after that, you're asking what's happening after that? Pastor Maury is coming after we get through with this journey. He is going to teach on the 1 John, that little short letter, the love book on 1 John. And we'll begin that 7 April. My question for you is this. I assume there'll be a new group of people coming, and maybe some of you will continue and others will want to go do something else. But how many people want lunch moving forward, going in the next weeks ahead? Some of you? Okay, well, we'll put that out there for registration, and as long as we have enough folks that want to, and I'm talking about lunch here, not take out, but we'll eat here together and have the fellowship. More and more of us are getting vaccinated. I keep telling the staff, more people are getting shot so we can But they didn't like that concept much. It's getting the shot for vaccination. Anyway, that's what it is. Good to see you today, and know that we're going to finish at 11:30 so that we can have our lunch and come. For those of you who want to come back in here for the all-family meeting, quarterly all-family meeting, we'll be back in here on time for that. All right, good to go. Thank you, John, and all those back there who make our sound better and better all the time, and the recording. I think, John, do we have last week's web up yet?
Last week's web?
Last week's web? Yes. Okay, it's up and going, and our group. Some people ask, well, how many people come to this Bible study? Well, usually 15 or 20 here lately in person, and then there's, I think, about 80 views on the website. So there's still a good group of people participating in the journey. They're just doing it from home in the comfort of their home, their recliner, and all that good stuff. And they can do it at any time they like. So I was supposed to go to a conference, and they made the conference virtual only. And so all these presenters at the conference, they're doing it from their homes on Zoom, you know. And so they made it such that instead of going these 3 days to the conference in Austin, you can watch it anytime you want. So I turn on one. You really don't need to see it. You just need to hear it. So I turn one on anytime I'm in my car. I turn on the conference and listen to it as I go. So I guess you could do that with this Bible study, couldn't you? Okay, we've got a lot of ground to cover. I know I have a lot more material here than what we can get through today, but I assure you next Wednesday when we come together, we're going to see the clouds of glory as they receive Jesus, and he's going to ascend, and we're going to get busy as we wait for him to descend yet again. So we're in the last days of this 30-year journey. And last time we witnessed the trials of Jesus before the Jews and the Romans, and he was condemned to death. We walked the Via Dolorosa, the streets of Jerusalem, out to the hill called Golgotha, also known Calvary. And there we witnessed the agonizing death of our Lord on the cross. Let's pray, and then we'll get back into what happened next. Father, we come before you in awe that you would love us so much that you would send your son who would die for us on Calvary, such a cruel, agonizing death, to pay for our sins, the penalty for our sins, not his own. Thank you, Father, for your son, for our salvation in him. In his name we pray, amen. So I'm going to Matthew. I've got all the text on the screen, I think, if John can keep up with me. A lot of text that I have to copy and paste it over to ProPresenter, and sometimes I do well and sometimes I don't. So if you see a hiccup, just hiccup with me and we'll keep moving on. So we're looking at the fact that he died. Last week he died, and now we're looking at what were the responses to the death of Jesus. Matthew 27:51. At the moment that Jesus died, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and rocks split. The tombs broke open and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. So the moment Jesus died in the temple, where did Jesus die? Just outside the city of Jerusalem. The temple is inside the city, and we've seen it many times. We haven't been in the Holy of Holies lately, but inside the temple itself, there was a special place called the Holy of Holies, and it was separated by a curtain, very, very thick, very tall curtain. And the scripture says that that curtain tore from top to bottom at the time Jesus died and this earthquake and that happened. That tearing of the curtain is very significant for us in that it it is symbolic of opening the way to God. Remember, the Holy of Holies is the place, there's only one person who goes in there. He only goes one time a year. And when he goes in, he has a rope tied around his ankle in case in case the glory of the Lord overpowers him and he dies on the spot and they'll drag him out. It represents the presence of God, right? So people don't get to see that. You might say, well, how did they know the curtain was torn into? Well, I assume the priests who go into that part of the temple would report it, because we know that many priests did believe and would report such a thing. Earthquake, we don't know much about the destruction of the city or anything, but tombs broke open. And again, if you grew up where I grew up, in Mississippi, we buried people 6 feet under. But there are other places on earth where they bury people above the ground. I remember when Hurricane Katrina came along, the National Guard, of which I was a part, was deployed to South Louisiana, and we went down to help recover. I saw many caskets had floated out of their tombs, and they were on the side of the Mississippi River levee because the water had been so high. So the tombs broke open, but these weren't broke open because of water or even the earthquake cannot answer that adequately, because not only did they break open, but the scripture says that the holy people, didn't say everybody, it said holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs and they went into the city. And that's about all we ever hear from that report. It seems like, man, we should hear a lot more about this. But again, God gives us what we need, not always what we want, right? And so it is that on Friday, the earthquake shakes up the city. I think part of this is a sign of God's condemnation of the crucifixion. Yes, God allowed Jesus to die, but he had to respond to the death of his son in such a way. That is, a very wicked thing took place, but God causes all things to work together for good, right? God used the death of his son for our good, but it wasn't good for Jesus, was it? We call it Good Friday, but good for us, not for Jesus. The tombs in the city opened, saints came out, and it may be that the writers here, Matthew in particular, is compressing this story such that the earthquake took place on Friday, but maybe these resurrected people didn't come out until Sunday when Jesus rose. I'm not exactly sure about that. There's a lot of symbolism, but the symbolism that is, I think, most significant to us is the tearing of that temple veil that allows us into the Holy of Holies. Now, let me give you an example of what this means. From a Protestant perspective, we pray in the name of Jesus. Our Catholic brethren, they may pray on behalf of a saint or Mary or some other. They go to the priest. Our Catholic brothers and sisters go to the priest for their to confess their sins. You don't come to me to confess your sins very often, and I'm glad of that. You don't need to. And why is that? Is it just because we do things differently? No. It's because this episode here, the tearing of the temple, signifies for us that we can go straight to God. We don't need to go through a mediator. Jesus is our mediator between us and God. So we pray directly to God. We don't need to go to the priest or through some other. Matthew 27:54, when the centurion, that Roman soldier, officer, and those with him who were guarding Jesus heard his cry and saw how he died, their response was, they saw the earthquake, what had happened, they're terrified, I think I would be too. They praised God and exclaimed, surely he, this man, Jesus, was the Son of God, or a righteous man. And then 27:55, many women who knew him were there watching from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee up in the northern part where he ministered much of the time, where his headquarters were, to care for his needs. These women, as in the church today, women play significant is not adequate. More than significant role in the life of the church. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joses, and Salome, the mother of Zebedee's sons, that'd be James and John. And so the centurion saw that evidently God's hand in all this, and he concluded, based on all the evidence that he saw, Jesus is the Son of God. He is who he said he was. And we would hope so too, right? Our faith in God is not blind faith. Our faith is based upon evidence, historical evidence and experiential evidence. If you have experienced the power of the Holy Spirit in your life, that's your own personal experience, and you can testify, God is alive and he changed my life. And so this Roman worship God, affirming Jesus to be who he said he was. The centurion wasn't the only one who was shaken up by the death of Jesus. There were the crowds there, many in mourning, fulfilling the prophecy in Zechariah 12:10. These faithful female followers, and again, their culture very different than ours. Women did not have equality. They did not have, in fact, oftentimes we read about how women were treated as if though property, and I think many people had the attitude that it was that way, that women belonged to their fathers when they were young and husbands when they married. But they came all the way from Galilee, which is, it's not far for us today in an automobile, but for them traveling on foot would have been quite a ways to go. They followed Jesus, disciples at a distance, you might say. But here and now, there's nothing they can do but stand idly by and watch their master, their rabbi, their Lord die, and their dreams. They had hopes, they had convictions, they had beliefs that he was the Messiah. And from their perspective, their dreams had been shattered because he could not fulfill their interpretation of Messiah based upon dying, especially the death on a cross. So Jesus died. Next thing is how Joseph of Arimathea comes and asks Pilate for Jesus' body. John 19. So we're shifting from Matthew to John 19:31. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be the special Sabbath. That would be the Passover Sabbath, because the Jews didn't want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath. They asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. I think the pollen is getting to my vocal cords. Sorry. The soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. So three crosses, right? Jesus in the middle. They break the legs of the men on the left and the right. Verse 33, but when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs, and instead one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear and began bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it has given testimony, and his testimony is true, that he knows that he tells the truth and testifies so that you may also believe. These things happen so that the scripture would be fulfilled, and the scripture says, not one of his bones will be broken. And as another scripture says, and they will look on the one they have pierced. So in not breaking Jesus' legs and in piercing his side to show evidence that he was dead, they fulfilled scripture unknowingly. It's Friday afternoon, probably about 3:00. The sun has come out again after a 3-hour period of darkness. And I guess the sun is heading toward the Mediterranean and over toward the setting in the west. And the sunset, I think scholars say it would have been about 6 p.m. at that time of year in Israel. We say Israel, but it was in the Roman Empire. So 6 p.m. marks the end of the day and the beginning of a new day in the Jewish clock, right? So the day was over. Not only is it a Sabbath day, but it's a special Sabbath day during the week-long high holiday of Passover. And according to the law in Deuteronomy, the Jews would not allow a body to be hung on a tree overnight, and especially on the Holy Sabbath. So the way the Romans hurried up the death, I guess maybe they got paid by execution rather than by the hour. And so they want to hurry it along. They can go home, but they break the legs. Remember, on the cross, down toward the bottom, there's a little cleat, what I would call a little cleat, a little step, where the person on the cross could push up and get some air to breathe because they're hung, you know, by their hands, their wrists. And so they break the legs so that they can't push up and get a breath, and thus they suffocate more quickly. And Pilate agreed to finish them off, get it done early so that the Jews... Hey, remember, Pilate wants to keep things good with the Jews. He's a politician, right? He wants to stay in office, and one of the ways he will stay in office is to keep the people content to the best he can. So they go and break the legs. They would do that with a big mallet. Break the leg. If it wasn't painful enough already. So the person on the cross would again convulse with pain, and as he's weakened now, not able to lift himself, would die probably within just a few minutes. The two insurrectionists on the left and right of Jesus, they died that way. Jesus was already dead. They pushed the spear up under his ribs or through his ribs, Jesus' ribs, and evidence that he is dead and fulfills the scripture. Oh, thank you, dear. You are a dear one. How did you know I needed that? Oh, so much better. So this prophecy is fulfilled. Let's go to Mark. So we've gone to Matthew, John, and now Mark 15:42. So as evening approached, Joseph of Arimathea, and just a parenthetical note that Arimathea is known in the Old Testament as Ramathaim Zophim. It was a town in Ephraim, and this would be north and a little bit west of Jerusalem, not very far. That's where he's from. It's also the birthplace of Samuel, the prophet in the Old Testament. A prominent member, Joseph of Arimathea is and again, one of the reasons, we talked about this last week, one of the reasons they say where he's from is to differentiate him from many other Josephs, right? He's a prominent member of the council, that is a good and upright man who had not consented to their decision and action. That would be the Sanhedrin, the ones who condemned Jesus to death, who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, went boldly, and that would be an understatement, went boldly to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Now, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jews. Okay, so he is, he's been an in-the-closet believer. Pilate was surprised to hear that Jesus was already dead, and summoning the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned from the centurion that it was so, he gave the body to Joseph. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. Less than 3 hours between the time the soldiers pierced Jesus' side and the setting of the sun, so they would have to act quickly. He was on the that is, Joseph was on the Sanhedrin, these, 70 men, but he disagreed. Whether he outwardly disagreed when the vote was taken or not, not sure, but in his heart, he didn't go along with it. Either a dissenting voice or maybe just decided to keep it to himself since he was in a vast minority. Secret disciple, perhaps fearing excommunication from the Sanhedrin and even from his family and such. So the fact that he was a wealthy man, I think, offers us a bit of interest in it. He was a follower and a faithful person after this, but he provided a tomb. We've seen pictures of the tomb, and it is... A cave, in essence, a cave. May have been a hand-hewn cave, but it's a cave in the limestone nonetheless. And some caves were hand-hewn and others were natural, but this limestone, much like we have around here, made it practical to do that. So Joseph asked Pilate for the body. Perhaps the death of Jesus drew him out of the closet. Maybe Joseph said, I've taken all I can stand. I've got to do something. And so in his own agony and regret, perhaps, he goes and does what he can. John 19:39, Jesus' body is placed in a tomb. Joseph was accompanied by Nicodemus. Y'all remember him, right? John, early on in John, the first few chapters. The man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Why would he do that? Because he's a member of the Sanhedrin as well, and he doesn't want to get excommunicated from that role. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds, and taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it, his body, with the spices in strips of clean linen cloth. And this was in accordance with the Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. That's very significant to me in that these things happened very geographically very close together. The Mount Calvary, Golgotha, and then very close, there's a garden. Again, probably a person of wealth. There was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb cut out of rock in which no one had ever been laid. So it's a brand new, never been used. They did reuse them, by the way. We'll get to that in a moment. It was a Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. And then he, that would be the Joseph and Nicodemus, they rolled a big stone in front of the entrance of the tomb and went away, or the Roman soldiers rolling the stone. Joseph, thankfully, he has someone who will step up and help, and that's Nicodemus. Joseph provides the tomb. Nicodemus provides the burial needs, the cloth and the ointments. Not anything like what we do today with preparing bodies, or even like the Egyptians, you know, in the mummification. This was primarily odor control for a decaying body. Myrrh was, a gummy kind of resin, and they comes from Arabia. A very powerful smell, and they would use it to, again, cover the smell of a decaying body. Probably put it in the folds of the cloth as they wrapped the body. The body would be, if I understand it right, they'd lay out this long piece of cloth. The body would be laid on there, and then you'd fold the cloth. And thus we have the Shroud of Turin. That's where that would come from. The Sanhedrin, acting quickly, you know, to get the body down, these two men get their business done. In the tomb, it says a new one. Nobody had ever been put there. Typically, a tomb is about 9 by 9 feet square, but short. If you visit the tombs there today, you'll have to duck to go in for sure. Some of us don't duck quite as much as others, but go in the tomb. And then there are these little niches that cut out in the sides of the wall of the 9 by 9, and that's where they would put the bodies. They would put the bodies there and leave them for a year, and then come back and collect the bones and put them in a box and leave that box in there. So they could, in essence, use the tomb multiple times. And again, a family tomb usually. So that's how Jesus was buried. Let's go to talk about the women for a moment and their response. We're in Matthew again, Matthew 27:61. Matthew 27:61. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary, that is the mother of Joseph, were sitting there opposite the tomb and saw where he was laid. So they're watching Joseph and Nicodemus, right? These women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. And then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the command. So I mentioned that when they rolled the stone, The Romans didn't roll the stone, did they? The Joseph and Nicodemus would have done that. The Romans, they later came and guarded the tomb. The tomb would have typically a stone or gate of some kind, to keep the varmints, the animals, out. And so the Romans actually put a guard, but they don't roll the stone. The women wanted to pay their respects. They're watching as the men take care of the body, and they go there, watch where it happens, and then they're going to come back later and continue the process of this preparation of his body. But they have to wait because of the Sabbath. They don't want to break the Sabbath rules. Matthew 27:62. So it's the next day, the one after the preparation day. The chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. And so they say, "Sir, we remember that while he was still alive, the deceiver," that's what they're calling Jesus, the deceiver. "He is the truth, the way, and the life," right? "After 3 days, I'll rise again. So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. And otherwise, his disciples will come and they'll steal his body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. And the last deception will be worse than the first." "Well, take a guard," Pilate answered, "and go and make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by pulling a seal on the stone, putting a seal on the stone and posting a guard. The seal would be probably a wax, a glob of wax with some kind of string or something that would, and if you move the stone, it would break the seal, and you're in trouble then, because that they would know that it's been broken, and the Romans, or even the Sanhedrin, they come get you. Bad news. So they put a seal on it. We don't want any more deception going on. Let's see, where are we? Let me move on down here to the resurrection. This is for us the most significant part as we talk about the resurrection of our Lord. If Christianity doesn't have the resurrection, we are to be pitied indeed, right? We are wasting our time. If Jesus didn't defeat death, because in him, in his resurrection, he conquered our most feared enemy, and that is death. John, the evangelist, record for us the most important message about life and death, and that is, he's alive again. There are five theories that people have come up with through the centuries to try to answer the testimony of the resurrection. One says, he didn't really rise from the dead. His followers stole his body. But I think what we just read from the scripture would give us ample evidence that they weren't about to allow that to happen, right? And why would they? So the stolen body is one. There's also the swoon theory, S-W-O-O-N. That is, people say, well, he wasn't really dead. When they got him in the tomb and it was a cool place, he was revived and just came back to, he was resuscitated, not resurrected. And then there are others who say, the women, when they went and found the empty tomb, they went to the wrong tomb. Now, we know that couldn't happen because they had been there watching it. And so, not a very good suggestion. Number four, hallucination. That is, the disciples wanted so badly for Jesus to rise from the dead that they created this image in their mind. And last, a myth, that the Gospels are just a story, a literary fiction with little basis in historic reality. Those of you who know the Jesus of Nazareth as your resurrected Lord and Savior, you know that all five of those theories are just that, theories. People have tried to come up with an answer to a supernatural event, and God gives them the freedom to try that if they want. Are we doing okay here? All right, we got an empty tomb. So the evidence of the resurrection of Jesus, very overpowering. There are a number of things that can only be accounted for by a literal bodily resurrection. And one is, is Acts, the book of Acts. On one day, there's 3,000 people who are converted to believing in Jesus. Now, would they, you think, a group of 3,000 people who were alive at the time of his life and death, and you think they would have gone for a hoax? There's also the transformation of people like Peter, you know, the skeptic, and Paul, actually Saul, who became known as Paul, and the also the fact that the apostles were, most of them we believe were martyred. They died for their faith. You think they'd die for a hoax, a deception? And then there's the continued sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper, and there's the day of worship that changed from the Sabbath to Sunday. The unswerving testimony of the early church. I mean, we're talking about 2,000 years of people who whose lives have been changed, including you and me. So there are millions of people throughout history. It is not a deception. It is the ultimate reality. Jesus is alive. And so Sunday week, we'll get up early and we'll shout it from the hilltops. He's alive. He's alive. And because he lives, we have life too. Let's go with the women to the tomb. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, or Joanna, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint his body. So they're going to continue this process. They're going to honor Jesus. And Matthew says that after the Sabbath, at dawn, at the first day of the week, that's before sunrise, right? Dawn is when you just begin to get pink in the sky. At dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb, and there was a violent earthquake, another earthquake, for the angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on the stone. His appearance was like lightning. His clothes were like white as snow, and the guards were so afraid that they shook and became like dead men. You've heard of the fight or flight response to fear. Well, nowadays they tell us there's three responses: fight, flight, or freeze. They were frozen. They couldn't flee, and so they stuck right where they were. They became like dead men. So Friday afternoon, Saturday evening, these women who were devoted to the Lord came back, having purchased and prepared these ointments for Jesus' body, wanting to show their love, their devotion to him. And imagine, if you can, being or walking along with those two women, or being one of them, still dark, early Sunday morning, going to the tomb. Along the way, the sunlight begins to peek a little bit over the Mount of Olives to the east, and suddenly there's an earthquake. Another one. Was it an after, what do they call those? Aftershock of the one a few days ago? That it happened on Friday, and this is Sunday morning. They're shaken emotionally and now physically, I think, unnerved by all this. And perhaps seeing the angel descend. The angel is there. They don't call him an angel. They see a man dressed. He's like Mr. Clean, right? Bright white clothing, etc. And so they see the man sitting on the stone that had been rolled away. The angel rolled away, right? Did he need to roll the stone away in order for Jesus to get out? No. The angel rolled the stone away so the women could see that he's not there. Mark 16:2. Very early in the next first day of the week, just after sunrise, while it was still dark. I'm not sure. That is, John says while it was still dark. Mark says it's after sunrise. So it's real early. It's before most folks would be up, I think. They were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, you know, who's going to roll away the stone to the entrance of the tomb? But when they looked up, there was the stone, very, very large. It had already been rolled away. And Luke says that when they entered the tomb, they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men, a young man, according to Mark, in clothes that gleamed like lightning, stood beside them, sitting on the right side. Are you okay going to a graveyard in the night? A lot of people wouldn't do that. I mean, this is in essence what it is, a tomb, a graveyard. But they pulled themselves together enough to, from the earthquake, to make it out to the gravesite, the tomb, and wondering, you know, well, how are we going to get in? Who's going to roll the stone away? We're not strong enough to do that. They find that it's already moved. They enter, and the body is gone. And the question then is not who's going to roll away the stone, but who got the body? What did they do with it? Where is Jesus? Lord, look at Luke 24:5 says, in their fright, the women bowed down, their fright of seeing this two men in white, brilliant white. They bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men, or angel, Matthew says, said to them, do not be afraid, for I know that you're looking for Jesus, the Nazarene who was crucified. Why do you look for the living among the dead? They talk so matter-of-factly and like, why don't you know this already? He's not here. He has risen. Come and see the place where he lay. Remember how you told you that while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again. And then they remembered his words. And Matthew 28 says, then go quickly and tell his disciples and Peter, Mark says, because remember, Peter's the one who had denied him three times. Peter's in a low, he, as we say in Mississippi, he's lower than a snake's belly in a wagon rut. He has messed up. Go tell Peter, he has risen from the dead and he's going ahead of you into Galilee, and then you'll see him just as he told you. Now I've told you. And so the angel confirmed, don't be afraid. Here's the thing that angels typically say, and Jesus is quoted as most often say, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. That's what God's message to us is. Come to me and you don't need to be afraid. Typically, first words out of the angel's mouth, and so it is here. And again, they're talking very matter-of-factly like, duh, don't you know that he's risen? And but again, maybe the women are slow to believe. The men sure were. The angel seems to be somewhat incredulous about their unbelief. But again, they needed time to take it all in. So the angel orders them to go quickly to the men, especially Peter, and let them know that Jesus is going to meet them in Galilee. He's in Jerusalem, right, down south. Galilee, Sea of Galilee, right, back up in that region, and probably on the Sea of Galilee. In fact, we'll go there next week as Jesus meets them on the shore and has breakfast with them and has a very special meeting with Peter. So for the next week, Jesus is going to appear in Jerusalem, around Jerusalem, but he will meet them very soon in Galilee. So after a month, Jesus has continued to reveal himself, resurrected self, in Jerusalem. It is now the time for the Feast of Pentecost. Pentecost celebrates the giving of the law, right, the Mosaic law. And so there, people are coming back to Jerusalem, right, and getting ready for the feast. And it'll be at that time that Jesus is going to ascend from the Mount of Olives. That's a very, very popular place, isn't it? If you ever get to go to Israel, go over on the Mount of Olives, get off by yourself, and just think, this is where Jesus ascended, and the Scripture says, this is where he's coming back. Mark 16, trembling and bewildered, yet filled with joy, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. And Luke 24 says, when they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. So the women were frightened. They were, I assume, confused, maybe even dizzy with joy, but they ran as quick as they could back to tell the 11. Why are there 11? Because Judas, you remember, committed suicide because of what he had done. And so without stopping to talk to anyone along the way, they run back to the 11 and go straight to Peter and John. The other nine, I'm sure, come gathering around, listening to what the women are telling them. And they are jaw-dropping awe, right? Wow. So let's go to the tomb again. Let's go with Peter and John this time. John 20, so she, that is Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them, came running from the tomb, and Simon Peter and the other disciple, that would be John, the one Jesus loved, said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb. We don't know where they've put him, but they did not believe the women because the words seemed to them like nonsense. So we can criticize the women for not believing the angel, but now we can criticize the men for not believing the women, right? We may all be slow to believe. And for me, belief is not a all or nothing kind of thing, right? Some of us, remember, belief, faith, trust, they're all the same word in the Greek text. So coming to the place of, do you have enough faith? Jesus said it only takes a mustard seed, just a one grain of mustard seed kind of faith, and you can move mountains. How much faith does it take to believe Jesus is the Son of God? Childlike faith, right? So they're frightened. They come back. They tell what's going on. The men don't believe them. We read John 20, right? It seems to be a discrepancy, doesn't it, between Luke and John about when and all this happened. But I think that the discrepancy, if we see one, is the fact that these two writers are focusing on something different. John is focusing on Mary and her unbelief at this point, convinced that Jesus' body has been stolen, not that he's been raised from the dead, like the angels announced. But Luke is talking, I think, to the whole group, the whole crowd of women. And as a whole, they believe that the angels, what they've said, and remember that Jesus predicted that he would indeed rise. And so maybe that accounts for the difference in the way they present the story. I'm moving forward on to John chapter 20. We've got a lot of ground still to cover and 5 minutes to do it. In fact, I don't think we're going to get to where I hope we would for today, but next time. John 20, verse 3. So Peter and the other disciple, again, John, started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple, John, why is John referring to himself as the other disciple? We'll talk about that later, but the other disciple outran Peter. Peter, I think, must be short in stature and wide in girth or something. He's not in good shape like John. Maybe he's an older guy. We don't know. But he that is bent over and looked into the strips, at the strips of linen lying there, but it didn't go in. So when Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb, he saw the strips of linen lying there by themselves, as well as the other burial cloth, the burial cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head, and the cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. And finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed, but Peter went away wondering, wondering to himself, what's happened? They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. And then the disciples went back to their homes. So they've seen the empty tomb, but they're still wondering what has happened. They get there. They start off side by side, but John outruns Peter. And when John sees the empty tomb and the cloth, You know, there's this theory that somebody stole Jesus' body. Do you think they would steal his body and unwrap the body and leave the cloth there? Don't think so. But his body is gone. Not there. The cloth is there. The text doesn't tell us that the cloth is in the exact position as if Jesus had transcended through the cloth, but it's lying there. And certainly anybody that would steal his body would not go to the trouble of preparing the cloth in that way. So John is struggling, gets to the tomb, sees the sight. They don't know it yet. And I can comprehend that. Shock, awe. I mean, we've just seen the rabbi, our Messiah. We've seen him cruelly, agonizingly crucified on the cross, and two others with him. I mean, that's enough to put your mind and emotions in shock. And now the body gone, and so they walk away confused. We've got time to look at Mary as she comes to the tomb, and then we'll quit for today. We're in Mark 16, verse 11. No, John 20, verse 11. But Mary stood outside the tomb crying, and as she wept, she bent over and looked into the tomb, and the two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been. So now the angels are inside the tomb where Jesus' body had been, on the little bench kind of thing. One at the head, the other at the foot, and they ask her, "Woman, why are you crying?" They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they put him." And at this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. So Peter and John, they go back to their homes. Here comes Mary, Mary Magdalene, which was, she loved the Lord with all of her heart, stooped in to look at the tomb to see for herself that he's gone. And she sees, well, she thinks it's angels, but she meets the Lord, doesn't recognize him that is the Lord. This is her first encounter, or maybe even the second encounter with the angels. And so they say, "Why are you crying? Why are you crying? What's the matter?" Again, it's like, duh. I guess we need to give the angels a break, don't they? They know what's going on and we don't. Before the angels have time to respond, there's Jesus behind Mary. Why Mary turned around to look, I don't know, but she doesn't recognize him. And this may be like the guys that are on the road to Emmaus, that somehow they are prevented from being able to recognize him in the moment. Maybe it was because God had made it that way for the time being. But at any rate, she's not looking directly at them. And then in John 20, 15, "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you put him, and I'll get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. But go instead to your brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and to your Father, to my God and to your God." And Mary Magdalene went to the disciples who had been with him and who were mourning and weeping, went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that what he had said these things to her. And when they heard that Jesus was alive and that she had seen him, they did not believe. Didn't believe. Well, let's stop right there. It is 11:30. We'll pause right there and pick up here next time we're together, and we'll go from there to the Mount of Olives and watch him ascend into the heavens.